Hi everyone. This video is going to be the first of several videos about the Laplace transform. The Laplace transform is one of my absolute favorite subjects to teach in differential equations. I absolutely love it. It's a technique that we can use to try to solve differential equations. I'm not going to go through all of how to solve them today because we have so many things to talk about with the Laplace transform. So here is just a quick snapshot of what we're going to do in this first video. I'm going to give you the definition. The Laplace transform, I'll state the definition in a minute, but let me just give you a quick preview. It's a way to transform a function of t into a new function of a new variable, which we will call s. We're not going to go into too much of like what it means in this video. I want to focus first on the algebra, and then we will start to use it to solve differential equations, and we'll give more meaning to what we're doing later. Let's start by saying what the Laplace transform of a function looks like. So here's how I'm going to write this. We will say the Laplace transform of the function f of t. It's a computation, and what that is the improper integral from 0 to infinity, e to the negative st times f of t, and then we're integrating with respect to t. Okay, this is really it for the Laplace transform of f of t, but there's a lot going on here. There's the computational aspects. There's also the conceptual aspects. What I would like to focus on to start our discussion of Laplace transforms is just the computational aspects. So I don't want to go too much into what this means right now. That will start to become clearer when we solve differential equations with the Laplace transform. Okay, so let's focus on the computations for a second. This is an improper integral. So if I were actually going to evaluate this, which we will do in a minute, actually, for the example f of t equals 1, first thing I would want to do is set it up as an improper integral. So I'm going to take my integral here from 0 to infinity and rewrite that as the integral from 0 to b of what we're anti-differentiating, so e to the negative st f of t dt. This is now a definite integral. After we've evaluated it, though, we'll let b go to infinity. Notice here that we have two variables in the integrand. We have this s and we also have t. However, we are anti-differentiating with respect to t, and then we are going to plug in these bounds for t. That means that at the end, when we're done with the Laplace transform, we shouldn't see t anymore. T will get anti-differentiated out. Okay, what will result at the end, whenever this improper integral exists, is a function of s. Let me write function of s like this. So this will exist sometimes, maybe for certain values of s. So whenever this improper integral exists, or whenever it converges. So that's what the Laplace transform is. It transforms us from a starting function of little t, typically we think of that as time, into a new function of a new variable s. Why do we do this? Well, let's not focus on that right now. We are going to use this ultimately to solve differential equations, but for the first few examples, what I would like to do is focus on how to use this improper integral, how to evaluate it. So let's start with the example f of t equals 1. All right, let's see how to use this definition on the constant function f of t equals 1. So let's put f of t into the definition. So we can say that the Laplace transform of the constant function 1 is going to be the integral from 0 to infinity, e to the negative st times the function 1 dt. All right, I'm not going to keep writing times 1 here. Additionally, this is an improper integral, and let's evaluate it correctly. What we're going to do is take that top bound and replace it by a finite number b, but then let b go to infinity. So this is going to be the limit as b goes to infinity of the definite integral from 0 to b, e to the negative st dt. OK, Okay, we're immediately ready to anti-differentiate this. There's no tricks needed. The antiderivative of e to the negative st is going to look like e to the negative st times, I think, negative 1 over s. Okay, so let's write that down. This is the limit as b goes to infinity of e to the negative st. But let's see, if I differentiated that, negative s would come down. So we need to cancel that out with a coefficient of negative 1 over s. And then we will evaluate this at the bottom bound of 0 and the top bound of b. Okay, let's go ahead and plug in that top bound. This is going to be the limit as b goes to infinity. I think what I will do is pull that negative 1 over s out in front, and then have e to the negative s times b minus e to the 0, which is 1. All right, take a look at that. Now, this is our first time working through a Laplace transform, but analyze in particular this quantity here, e to the negative sb. Does that converge as b goes to infinity? I mean, does it have a limit that's finite? Does it blow up? And I will come back and finish. All right, for this first term here, if negative s is a negative number, as b goes to infinity, this expression will go to 0. So this goes to 0 if negative s is less than 0. It's kind of a strange thing to say, but I mean that this is like a negative number times something which is getting large, so that overall this product here looks like it's going to negative infinity, in which case that first term would go to 0. If, on the other hand, negative s were positive, then we would be looking at e raised to a power which is going to infinity, and that would not exist as a finite number. That blows up. So we have a limit here which exists whenever, say, s is positive. And when that happens, this is 0. So 0 minus 1 times negative 1 over s overall is 1 over s. But again, that limit only exists when s is greater than 0. That's it. That's the Laplace transform of the constant function f of t equals 1. Notice we have transformed from a function of the time variable to a function of s. Again, I don't want to dig too much into this, but I just want to say that that's what we expect to happen with a Laplace transform. We go from a function of little t to a function of s. Okay, let's talk through another property of the Laplace transform. One of the useful properties about the Laplace transform is that it preserves linear combinations. It's a linear transform. What that means is that the Laplace transform of a linear combination that looks like a times f of t plus b times g of t, where here a and b are numbers, can be written as the linear combination of those individual Laplace transforms. So a times the Laplace transform of f plus b times the Laplace transform of g. Let me just demonstrate why this is going to happen. It comes right out of the linearity of integration. So let's say, what is the Laplace transform of a times f of t plus b times g of t? There we go. Okay. By definition, it's going to be this improper integral from 0 to infinity of e to the negative st times, I'm just going to write af plus bg to be more concise. So af plus bg dt. We can distribute, so let me do that. This is going to be the integral from 0 to infinity of, I'm going to distribute and pull the constant a in front. So a times e to the negative st times f of t plus b e to the negative st g of t. I'm still working inside of one integral, so let me drop some parentheses in here. So it's dt. But the integral of a sum is the sum of the integrals. As I break this up into two integrals simultaneously, let me also pull out the constants a and b. Nothing here should be too surprising. This is a times the integral from 0 to infinity of e to the st f of t dt plus b times the integral from 0 to infinity e to the negative st g of t dt And now we're almost done, because if you just look at this, that looks like the Laplace transform for f. And similarly, this looks like the Laplace transform for g. So we've arrived at our conclusion. This is going to be a times the Laplace transform of the function f plus b times the Laplace transform of the function g. And that's exactly what we wanted. Okay, here's another super useful property about Laplace transforms, and this is really the key to everything, because we're going to use Laplace transforms to solve differential equations. So this gives us a way of computing, say, the Laplace transform of first derivative, and from this, we can actually build up the Laplace transform of the second derivative and the third derivative by repeating this process. But for now, let's just focus on this Laplace transform of the first derivative. So the context here is, imagine that we have some function y of t, and I would like to recast the Laplace transform of its derivative, dy dt, in terms of the Laplace transform of the original function. I've got the result up here, but let me show you where it came from. Oops, there we go. Okay, so what is the Laplace transform of dy dt? Where, again, this might seem strange, but imagine that y of t is just some function like t squared, and so I'm trying to take the Laplace transform of 2t. So think of it that way. It's just a function. It's a function of t. We can put it right into the definition of the Laplace transform and say that this is the improper integral from 0 to infinity of e to the negative st times whatever that function of t is. So how about dy dt for short? Okay, there's really just one way to handle this kind of expression. Should jump right out at you what we're going to need to do here. We have a product. So we have this times this. They don't seem to have anything to do with each other. U substitution is not going to be the key idea here. One of them is literally a derivative. So this should just scream integration by parts. All right, what we're going to do is let u equal the exponential. So u will be negative st. Du will be negative s e to the negative st dt. Dv is going to be dy dt dt. Which means that v is just plain old y, whatever that function is. I should probably do this correctly. So let me take that upper bound of infinity and replace it. Let me do that right here with a number b. And then we'll say that this is the limit as b goes to infinity of the integral from 0 to b, e to the negative st dy dt dt. Okay, the reason why I wanted to do that is for integration by parts, I need to take the product of u and v and evaluate them on the bounds. So I just wanted to have the bounds correctly set up. Okay, let's drop down here. So as I just said, for integration by parts, we're going to take u, multiply it by v. So this is going to be the limit as b goes to infinity of y e to the st evaluated at 0 and b. And then let me keep going inside the brackets here. We're going to do minus the integral from 0 to b of this times that. So v du. Notice s is just like a constant here because we're integrating with respect to t. I've got negative s. Let's pull that out front and have plus s times the integral from 0 to b of e to the negative st y dt. So this is just integration by parts. Let's keep going. And I think what I'm actually going to do now is write this limit twice. Maybe I should have done that on this line. We will have the limit as b goes to infinity of y of b. I've just been writing y, but the idea here is that y is a function of t. So when we plug in b, we get y of b, e to the negative sb minus y of 0, e to the 0. Okay, so that's going to be that first term evaluated at 0 and b. And then plus s times the limit as b goes to infinity of the integral from 0 to b, e to the negative st y dt. Okay, we're almost done. I'm almost out of room, though. I think I can finish on the next line. Once again, this exponential, e to the negative sb, there's really just two options depending on the sign of s. When s is positive, this expression will go to zero as b goes to infinity. When s is negative, however, it will grow to infinity. So let's go ahead and write zero here. No point writing down the situation where this doesn't converge. Let's focus on when it does converge. It's going to be zero minus, this is just y of zero times e to the zero, plus s times this expression. Now, if you want, you can take away this limit and replace this top bound with infinity, and it would look exactly like the definition of the Laplace transform of y. So this is going to be plus s times the Laplace transform of y, and now we're done. I want to wrap up this video with a brief justification of the types of Laplace transforms that we are going to do. So what kind of functions do we see typically emerge as solutions or pieces of solutions to, say, first and second order differential equations? We see exponentials, sines and cosines, polynomials, and combinations of those. Those are exactly the kinds of functions that we want to transform. So far I did only one Laplace transform. I took the Laplace transform of the constant function f of t equals 1, but we're going to do the Laplace transform of all of these functions over the next few videos. There is a formal check to see if taking the Laplace transform makes sense. What you would want to do is check if your function is of, say, exponential order alpha. So let me just talk through this definition, but I don't want to take it further than that. We say a function f of t, something that we might want to transform, is of exponential order alpha if there exist fixed positive numbers capital T and capital M, so that the size of the function, which we measure with the quantity, the absolute value of f of t, is bounded above by an exponential function, the exponential function m times e to the alpha t for all t values beyond capital T. So basically, if your function is smaller than an exponential of this form, you're good to go. And all of these you can check fit into this definition. So what we're going to do over the next few videos is focus on the algebra of taking Laplace transforms. So first, we're going to just take the Laplace transforms of exponential functions. Then we'll look at trig functions and polynomials. We'll start to put together the pieces that we need in order to tackle differential equations with Laplace transforms.